Assalamu alaikum students. Today in real analysis, we are going to study countable and uncountable sets. But before we start with the definition of a countable set, let us discuss how we compare two sets in mathematical analysis. Okay? So let us discuss how to compare two sets. Okay. So let us consider two sets. Suppose we have a set A with elements A, B, and C, and we have another set with elements 1, 2, and 3. So here we are going to compare these two sets. So which thing do you see in common in both of these two sets? You can see that both of the sets have the same number of elements. Okay. We can also say that the set A and set B have the same size. Okay. The size in a set is basically the number of elements in that set. Okay. So A and B have the same number of elements, or they have the same sizes. And there is another term that we use for the number of elements or size of a set, and that is cardinality. So what is cardinality? So cardinality of a set is the number of elements or the size of that set. So the number of elements or size of a set is called its cardinality. Okay. So we can say that the set A and set B have the same cardinalities. Okay. So the sets which have the same cardinalities are also called equicardinal sets or equivalent sets. Okay, here A and B are equicardinal. So they have the same cardinalities. They are equicardinal, or we can use a symbol like this, that A is equivalent to B, or A is equicardinal to B. Now let us compare the elements of these two sets. So let us draw a correspondence between the elements of these two sets. So we will see what type of correspondences we can have between the elements of these two sets. So let us take a correspondence. So here we take the elements of set A. So this is our set A, and here we take the elements of set B. Okay, now let us draw a correspondence between these two sets. So we can correspond, for example, the element A to the element 1 in the second set. Similarly, we can correspond B to 2 and then C to 3. Okay, so this is our set B. So we have drawn a correspondence or mapping between these two sets. And as you can see here, that for every element in set A, there is a unique element in set B. So this means that this correspondence is a function from the set A to the set B. Okay, so here, so this is a function suppose F from A to B. Okay, so here the set A will behave as domain of that function, and the set B will be codomain. Okay. Now, why don't we call it range? So, what is the difference between a codomain and range? Basically, the range of a function can be a subset of this codomain. So, it can be either equal to or less than this codomain. So, this is the difference between a codomain and range. So, here we have drawn a correspondence, a function between A and B. So, what type of function is it? As you can see here that any two different elements of set A are associated with different elements in set B. So, it means that two different elements of set A have different images in the set B under this function. You know that this type of function is called a one-to-one function. Okay, so this correspondence or function is one-to-one. So here, this function is one-to-one. And also you can see here that here all the elements of the set B are taken by this function. It means here the range of this function is basically equal to the set B itself. So such a function is also called an onto function. So this is also an onto function. Okay. A one-to-one function is also called an injective function. Okay, and onto is called a surjective function. Okay. So here this function between the sets A and B is one-to-one and onto, or it is both an injective function as well as a surjective function. So such a function is also called a bijective function. Okay, so this is basically a bijective function. Okay, so here we have seen that if the number of elements in two sets are the same, or the cardinalities of two sets are the same, or if two sets are equicardinal or equivalent, then we can draw a bijective mapping or a bijective function between the two sets. So now let us consider two sets which have different cardinalities. For example, if we have now another set C with elements suppose A, B and C, and the set D with elements 1 and 2. So now how can we correspond their elements? So we can join, for example, 1 to A, B to 2, then again C to 1. You can see that this correspondence is a function, but now this is not a one-to-one function. It is onto but not one-to-one function. So this is not a bijection. Similarly, if we have different sets like E and F, again with different cardinalities, now this time A is with elements A, B and F is with elements 1, 2, 3. So here again, if we draw correspondence between the elements, you can see, and this time it is not even a function. So it is not a bijection either. So we can draw a bijection between the two sets only when they have the same cardinalities or when they have the same number of elements. So a mathematician, George Cantor, used this concept to basically compare two infinite sets. Okay. So for example, if the sets are finite, then we can easily compare the elements from one set to the elements in the other set. But if they are not finite, if they are infinite, then we cannot compare all their elements. We cannot associate every element of one set to every element of the other set. Okay, so we can use this concept. If we can define a bijection between the two infinite sets, then they are equicardinal, they have the same size or the same number of elements, or they are equivalent. So here we can have a definition two sets, set A and B, are equicoordinate or equivalent if and only if there is a bijection defined between them. Okay, so if we have two finite sets, then it is quite easy to compare their elements and to decide which set has greater number of elements and which set has smaller number of elements, or which set has greater cardinality and which one has lower cardinality. But if we have infinite sets, then we cannot identify their cardinalities by just corresponding their elements. So we use this phenomenon that if we can draw a bijection between the two sets, then those sets will have the same cardinality, so they will be equicoordinate. Or if they are equicoordinate, then we can draw a bijection between them. So now let us consider some examples of infinite sets and see their cardinalities. For example, so we take examples. So let us consider the set N of natural numbers, set N of natural numbers or positive integers, and the set E, which is the set of even numbers. Okay, so here one can easily see that the set of even numbers is a subset of the set of natural numbers. So can they have the same cardinality? So one might think that since this set is a subset of this set, so the set of even numbers is kind of smaller than the set of natural numbers, so they cannot have the same cardinalities. But the answer is yes, they can have the same cardinalities. So they are of the same size. Why? Because we can consider a bijective mapping or bijection between them. For example, in the set of natural numbers and the set of even numbers, if we consider a function f of n is equal to 2n. Okay, so here we consider a function from the set of natural numbers to the set of even numbers. And for example, if n is 1, then we get 2. If n is 2, then we get 2 times 2, which is 4. N is 3, we get 6, and so on. So here you can see that to each natural number, there corresponds a unique even number. So this function is, so the function that we have taken over here, f of n is equal to 2n, so this function is basically a bijective function or bijection. So since we have defined a bijection between the set of natural numbers and the set of even numbers, so according to this definition or this theorem, they have the same size or they have the same cardinalities or they are equivalent. Okay, so here the set of natural number is equicoordinate or equivalent to the set of even numbers. So they are of the same size. So both of them are infinite sets, but they have the same number of elements. Okay, so these two infinities are of the same size. Similarly, let us consider another example. Again, the set of natural numbers and the set of odd numbers. So again, the set of odd numbers is a subset of the set of natural numbers, but we can define a mapping between the set of natural number and the set of odd numbers, which is a bijective mapping. For example, if we consider this function, that f of n is equal to 2n plus 1. So this is a mapping or function from the set of natural numbers to the set of odd numbers. And this is again a bijective mapping or bijection. So this implies again that the set of natural number and the set of odd number are also equicordinal or equivalent. And how about the set of natural numbers and the set of integers? So are these two sets equivalent or equicordinal? So what do you think? So another example, and this time we consider the set of natural numbers n and the set of integers z. So are they equicordinal? So the set of natural numbers is 1, 2, 3 and so on, and the set of integers is, it has 0, minus 1, plus 1, minus 2, plus 2 and so on. Okay, so are these two sets equicordinal? So here you can see that we can draw a correspondence between these two sets in such a way that with each natural number we can correspond an integer. Okay, so we can correspond every integer with a natural number. So again, this correspondence will be a one-to-one and onto, or injective and surjective, or also a bijective correspondence. So again, we can draw a bijective mapping between these two sets. So again, although the set of natural numbers is a subset of the set of integers, but they have the same sizes, they are equicordinal. So here again, the set of natural numbers is equicordinal with the set of integers. Another example, how about the set of rational numbers? So let us now consider the set of natural numbers and Q, the set of rational numbers. So are they equivalent? You know that the set of rational numbers is basically the set of all fractional numbers P over Q, where P and Q both are integers. Okay. Or here, for this case, if P and Q are positive, we can consider that they are natural numbers. Okay, so we can make this fraction P and Q by taking any two natural numbers. So again, we can list the elements of the rational numbers by taking the natural numbers from the set of natural numbers. So again, there is a correspondence or bijection between the set of natural numbers and the set of rational numbers. So the set of natural number and the set of rational numbers are also equivalent or equicordinal. So they are of the same size. And how about, so now let us consider some non-examples. The set of natural number and the set of real numbers. So are they equicordinal or equivalent? So no. So the answer is no. Okay. The set of natural numbers and the set of real numbers are not equicordinal. Okay, they do not have the same size, or we cannot define a bijective mapping between N and R. So the set of natural number and the set of real numbers both are infinities, but the set of real numbers is a bigger infinity than the infinity of natural numbers. So here in this whole discussion, we have seen that two sets will be equicordinal or equivalent if we can define a bijection between them. Or if there is a bijection between any two sets, then they are equicoordinal, they are equivalent, they have the same sizes. Now we are in a position to define a countable set. So let us define a countable set. So what is the definition of a countable set? A set, suppose E is countable if it is either a finite set or it is equicoordinal or equivalent to the set of natural numbers. Okay, so a set which is either finite, so every finite set is a countable set. So a set which is either a finite set, or if it is not finite, but if it is equivalent or equicoordinal to the set of natural numbers, then it is a countable set. So this means that, so if we can draw a bijection between the set of natural numbers and this set E, then the set E is countable. Okay. So we can also define it, or if there is a bijection between the set of natural numbers n and the set E, then it is countable. Okay. So a set will be countable if either it is finite set, or even if it is infinite, but there is a bijection between the set of natural numbers and that set, then that set is countable. So as previously we have discussed that the set of even numbers, the set of odd numbers, and the set of integers, and the set of rational numbers, all are basically equivalent or equicoordinal to the set of natural numbers. So this means that they are all countable sets. So what are the examples of countable sets? So the set of even numbers, let's call it E. Similarly, the set of odd numbers, O. The set of integers, Z, and the set of rational numbers, Q. So they are all countable. Okay. So these sets are countable because each one of these sets is equicordinal with the set of natural numbers, or there is a bijection between each one of these sets and the set of natural numbers. Since they are infinite sets and they are also countable, so they are also called countably infinite. So these are countably infinite. Okay. So an infinite set which is countable is also called a countably infinite set. Now let us write some theorems regarding countable sets. Okay, so we are going to now have some theorems based on countable sets. So number one, every subset of a countable set is countable. So if we have a countable set, then any subset of that set will also be a countable set. Number two, a countable union of countable sets is countable. So these theorems can be easily proved based on the fact that a set is countable if there is a bijection between that set and the set of natural numbers. Okay, or if that set is a function of the set of natural numbers. So we can prove these theorems by sequencing the elements of a countable set with the elements of natural numbers. So with this, we come to the end of today's lecture. So see you in the next lecture.